Hello everyone, this is Pika Struff and welcome into my journey to the 3D Zelda Challenge. This episode will be dedicated to Ocarina of Time, and specifically the Ganondorf Source Requirement category that is done in this case, at least as per the rules of the 3D Zelda Relay, which is what I am following for this challenge. Before really starting with this video, I just want to say that it really looks like the challenge as a whole will take me longer than I initially thought. I imagined that I would be able to make one video a month, which would be possible if that was the only thing I was dealing with at the moment, but my current Breath of the Wild 80% goals have made me unfocused on this for a while, so the whole one video a month thing might be dropped. But still, I will make sure to remain fairly steady when it comes to learning these games and working on those videos. I still have early 2020 as my goal for the entire thing to be done, but I am not sure exactly when is all. Anyways, let's move on to the actual video and talk about Ocarina of Time GSR. It took me a lot of time to finish learning this category. I would give a good estimate of 12 plus hours for just doing a bare run through of the run while learning. All of that before doing the first run. And considering my only speed games are Breath of the Wild and Skyward Sword 80%, at the moment that I actively ran for some time, I can definitely say that Ocarina of Time is not an easy game to learn. However, its difficulty also makes it a very rewarding experience. Therefore, let's break down how we will go through all of it, shall we? Our plan is 1. Firstly, what is the category itself? What is its goal? Its structure? What should be generally expected from it? This is where I will be doing a brief walkthrough of what is it that happens in this category, which should give you an idea of the whole picture. 2. Then after all that, I will be talking about its difficulty and, very importantly, resources for new runners to learn the category, as well as my own advice that I shall offer for newcomers. That way, if you ever are interested, you can get to know where are the best places to look for help through that section, as well as learn some things that perhaps may not be obvious from the various tutorials that exist out there, or just are outdated, which therefore should be of great help to you. Thirdly, I will be talking about its marathon safety, which is very important to consider since this run will be done in the 3D Zelda Challenge. For those who may not know what is meant by marathon safety, it is how risky the run is when it comes to its tricks and skips. For instance, are there any strats that can only be tried once, otherwise basically killing the run? Are there strats that have a risk of crashing the game or generally could send you back for a large amount if failed? A run that is considered marathon safe would contain few, if any, of such tricks. If they do, there usually are backup strats that can be used so there is no risk of tanking the run unnecessarily. After all, it is important to remember that in marathons, you can't just reset a run. Once you started, you have to finish it. So definitely you don't want to find yourself being forced to stop the run or losing 15 minutes because you screwed up a risky strat. This is likewise the case for the 3D Zelda Challenge, as by definition it is a marathon of all 3D Zelda games, and therefore, how safe the run is something important to consider. Now, don't forget, in the description I have a table of contents with all the timecodes for all sections of the video, so you can easily navigate it. I really hope it may be of help to you when viewing this video. Without further ado, let's go through all of that and talk about speedrunning Ocarina of Time GSR and how it will fare in the 3D Zelda Challenge. 1. What is the category? The Ganondorf Tools Requirement category consists of one thing to really consider. Instead of using the usual wrong warp method using any percent to access the end of the game, here instead we need to actually make sure we enter Ganon's tower in the quote-unquote intended way, and then make our way to the end. However, how is it all structured, from the moment you start a new game to the moment Ganon receives the final blow? Let's go briefly through the structure of the category as it is right now, when playing on Virtual Console at the moment of making this video. I won't go right now into the details of the tricks and skips, for they are really well explained in Zelda's tutorial, but I will definitely go back over the moments which I need to be talked about in more details. The run starts with Link waking up in Kokiri Forest, in his house, nothing unusual. After that, Link proceeds to go obtain his sword and shield, and then we have to go sequence break to escape the forest immediately after. We then proceed to go to Kakariko Village as soon as possible, and then use one of a couple methods in order to get to the bottom of the well early, all in order to open up a little chest containing bomb chews, which are vital in the run. After that, we make our way to Hyrule Castle and get Zelda's lullaby, using various tricks in order to do so rapidly. Once that is obtained, we rush to the Temple of Time and clip through the Door of Time to go get the Master Sword, therefore already becoming an adult before even completing any of the child dungeons. Once the cutting is over and are an adult, then go to Kakariko Village to get the hookshot. We then get ourselves crushed by the door to then go back to the graveyard and then perform a hookshot jump to the outer wall, and then performing an ice G in order to stay on these edges, then slowly walking all around that to then finally do a side hop down the stairs and finally entering the Shadow Temple. Once we're inside the Shadow Temple, we then veer straight to the left and then proceed to kill that horrible monster that liked to spook us all as kids, also called Dead Hand, if you forgot those nightmares. Once that terrifying thing is dead, we then proceed to open the chest to get the hover boots, and then get to something that can be quite scary when starting off, called the BK Skip, short for Bosky Skip, which is basically skipping the entire dungeon using bump shoes, the hover boots, and lots of weird stuff. Now this one has a lot of explaining to do, and I do want to explain it a bit more, so don't worry, I will come back to it later. But on a very insultingly basic level, we use bump shoes and hover boots to clip out of the room, and then perform a bunch of shenanigans which I will explain later to then clip into the boss room. We then jump down the hall and happily kill Bongo Bongo using our trusty hookshot and this nice and beautiful trick called Ice G. Kill Bongo Bongo and then collect the Shadow Medallion. Good! That's the first of the two medallions required to access Ganon's castle at the end of the run. But don't you dare think that we are anywhere close to the end, because we aren't. Once the cutscene is over, we then proceed to go over to Dodongo's cavern to collect the bombs, which are surprisingly easy to get considering there is a lot of movement you can do as Adultling that completely breaks this dungeon. So really, this is a more relaxing part of the run. After obtaining the bombs, we then need to go visit the fairy at the top of Death Mountain in order to get the magic bar, which will be necessary for the light arrows at the end of the run. After that, unlike what you may think, the next step isn't to directly go on our way to Gerudo Desert, since we need both the Shadow Medallion and the Spirit Medallion for the bridge to be built over to Ganon's Tower. We still have one last thing to obtain, which is the Minuet of Forest, and it will make sense later. To do that, since we were just at the Fairy Fountain on top of Death Mountain, instead of traversing all of Hyrule, luckily all we need to do is go down to Goron Village, use a bomb to break up those boulders to take the shortcut, and here we are in the Lost Woods. We then skip Mido using a bit of a precise jump with a hookshot, and then go to the Sacred Meadows to then get the song. Now to optimize our stuff, we don't just get the song. We perform a cutscene skip by dying at the same time as we pass the trigger of the cutscene, therefore meaning that when we save and reload the game after quitting it, all the way back in Temple of Time, we do have the song. Now that this is done, we then go on our merry way to Gerudo Desert, using some movement techniques that will be quite vital, including, for instance, super sliding from Hyrule Castle Town all the way to Gerudo Valley. After that, we then do what is called a mega side hop to skip the bridge, allowing us to therefore straight away getting to Gerudo Fortress. I will come back to the mega side hop later. We then arrive in the fortress, and our first action shall be to get caught right away. We will therefore arrive in the prison, which will allow us to hookshot ourselves up at this area, and then using a bit of precise positioning, clip through the ceiling above. Okay, now, right here, we may use a few methods to do what we call a gate skip, which allows us to skip, well, the gate right here, since we are generally intended to go save the carpenters from the fortress, but you know, that's slow, so no, we're not gonna do that. Luckily, there are multiple reliable methods to skip it, they are all well explained in the tutorial that is linked in the description below, so it shouldn't be too much of a challenge for new runners to learn. Once you get past the gate, now here comes a pretty scary part, the wasteland. What needs to be remembered about this specific part is that if Link wanders off in certain areas, this will make him void out, and therefore respawn all the way at the beginning. This means that from the moment we arrive in Wasteland to the moment we arrive at the Desert Colossus, we are constantly walking with a sword of Damocles up above our heads. But once we come back to all those difficult tricks and skips that I've been talking about so far in the next section of the video, don't worry, I will help clearing this up so it may help you as much as possible. Once we arrive at the Desert Colossus, we are now faced with two options, which is to either perform what we call a Spirit Hover in order to reach directly from the entrance of the dungeon to the Mirror Shield, or alternatively, go through a section of the Spirit Temple and then get the Mirror Shield by coming out of the quote-unquote intended way. While just a bit slower, I would definitely recommend going with doing Spirit Temple as a beginner, and in fact, there is something vital to consider about it regarding the marathon safety of the run that concerns this section, so we will come back to it at that moment. Once we get the Mirror Shield, we then proceed to just either go get the boss key, which is definitely what I recommend, and then perform a guest side hop in the mirror room while unloaded to then go get the boss door and open it that way. There is a faster BK skip, which I am not sure I would recommend for beginners like me, but it is definitely important to let it be known it is a thing. Luckily, Zelie's tutorial goes well over this method, There are a couple of risks to take into account when going through that section, however, so definitely I will come back to that later. After getting past the boss door, we beat Nuburu, beat Twin Rova, and then obtained the Spirit Medallion. At this point, we now therefore possess the two medallions in that the game internally checks to therefore trigger the Light Arrow cutscene in the Temple of Time. However, we still have to do one last thing before that. Remember the Minuet of Forest earlier? Well, now is the time to use it. After the Spirit Medallion cutscene, we teleport to Forest Meadows to then go to the Forest Temple. It doesn't take too long and requires quite a few clips and tricks that occasionally can be a bit tricky, but definitely are within possibility. But what needs to be done is just to reach the bow. Once the bow is obtained, then and only then, we get out of the temple and save and quit to then load back to Temple of Time, leading us to that cutscene, in which Zelda will then give us the light arrows, which can only function when you have the magic bar and the bow. See why we did all that earlier? Now it makes sense. After all that, we then proceed to go to Ganon's castle, after watching the Rainbow Bridge cutscene. Once we are in, we then proceed to perform what we call the trial skip, which allows us to skip, well, all of the trials that we normally need to be completed in order to open up the tower. And now we are in Ganon's tower. It is time to rise up to him. We proceed to climb up, going through fairly trivial fights for the most part, considering the Iron Knuckles can kill Link in one hit, meaning that those fights need to be well done. But luckily, Zelda's tutorial explains really well the fighting techniques that you need to use against them. Now we then proceed to beat Ganondorf using the light arrows and the power of ISG, again, and we now reach the collapse phase where we must escape the tower. Luckily though, while it is technically possible to just do it casually, we can do what we call a void warp to skip most of it. As per the drill, no worries, the next section is where I will go a bit over it, but of course, Zelda's tutorial explains it really well as well. After all that is said and done, we finally are at the final battle. We therefore super slide into the battle to keep the Master Sword and proceed to slay Ganon down and save Hyrule in only a couple hours. And there we go, that was a preview of what is to be expected from Ocarina of Time GSR. Phew, I hope you're still following. As you may see here, this is quite a journey that we do in this speedrun, and there are many moments that are quite scary. However, having learned how to go through this category multiple times by myself, by now, we shall now move on to the next section of this video, where I will point you out to the best resources in order to learn the category yourself, as well as explanations and advice on certain sections of the run that I feel are worth talking about on their own. Now, without further ado, let's go through with that help with learning the category. First off, for this section, let's start with the tutorials that you should be using in order to learn the category. There is, very luckily, one big tutorial going over the entire route made by Zelly. It is composed of three videos, one being about basic movement in Ocarina of Time speedrunning, the second one being about the child section of the run, meaning from the beginning until the Master Sword is pulled out, and finally the third video being about the entire adult section, i.e. most of the run. Where we are very lucky is that it is a really high quality tutorial that is in-depth, talks of multiple route options, and just generally well detailed, explaining quite well everything that could be needed. This isn't something that can be said of all games, so definitely this is a good thing. However, there are some outdated route options in certain sections that I definitely want to go over. Likewise, I will go over the previously discussed sections, which, while they were mostly well covered by Zelly, I feel like I want to highlight certain particular things about them that might not seem obvious to new runners, or just that I feel are important to be said. Let's get to it. One thing I want to get out of the way, because it is single-handedly the most important bit, is regarding the BK skip in Shadow Temple. Because simply put, the method that Zelly teaches in his tutorial is outdated. While it was definitely a good method at the time he made the video, there is now a much better method that is quicker, easier, and much more consistent. For that, I would really like you to check out MariMBS tutorial, of which I will put the link in the description. That video covers mainly how to clip out from the room where you obtain the hover boots all the way to the room with the boss door. Zelda's video, however, can be used as reference likewise for actually clipping into the boss room. However, I would like to myself give some notes about this particular moment, which to me is one of the scariest parts of the entire run. This whole trick depends on being able to do two things. Firstly, clipping out of the room and landing into the room right before the boss. The second thing, clipping into the boss room. Now, first off, after saving, as soon as you get the hover boots in case you fail the trick too many times, you pretty much start off the same as is explained in the tutorial I mentioned earlier. Put Link facing towards the chest, in the middle, and shield turn right. Then, side hop left and side roll. Now, at this point, the tutorial recommends turning Link around to the correct positioning using the ESS position on the control stick. And while it is a consistent method, I personally had a lot of trouble with it, because I just suck at ESS turns. While it will be necessary at some point to get good at this, I do have a temporary solution that, while it is definitely slower, also most definitely works. Simply put, press C up so that you can aim with the camera. Then you want to put the camera that way, your Q being the lower tip of the sword icon being a bit to the right of the middle of the head of that skull. Once that is done, you can then keep going as the tutorial explains and go down to the room with the boss door. Now comes the scary part of this whole BK skip. The reason why it is difficult, as you may already see from the footage, is that the entire room is invisible due to being unloaded, the only thing being present being the collisions for the floor and walls. Once you have landed on the floor after the initial clip out of bounds and side hop left twice as per the tutorial, you then remove your hover boots. What is difficult with this is to first of all locate yourself within the room fairly accurately so you know where to go. If you are unsure, you can pull out the hookshot and use the red dot as a cue for the walls, as well as shoot it so you may exactly see how close you are to the wall. You can also check on the practice ROM how exactly that dot behaves, such as for instance notice the moment when it disappears, because this means that you can then back in an actual run use the moment the dot reappears as a cue for setting a correct angle. And then walking forward until you hit the wall, do make sure that the hookshot does actually hit something, just in case so you don't fall off. That would be bad. Once you find yourself up on the wall, you can then target and then proceed to continue just as on the main tutorial from Zeldy, since the method he uses in that tutorial works just as well. As a little side note, if the clip into the boss room seemingly doesn't work because the bomb tree explodes prematurely, do not worry, for since your shield turned right earlier, all you have to do is just roll forward for a bit, turn to the left and go again to the wall, and your angle should be reset at this point. Likewise, if you fail the last step of the clip-in and just get back in bounds with Link standing up, you normally are in front of the boss door, in which case targeting should be enough for the angle to be set correctly to restart the process. If Link falls down due to failing the last step, he will unfortunately have to restart the entire trick all over again. And this is where having saved right before starting will be useful, in the case that you either lack hearts or are out of bomb chews, since in that case you may just reload the save and come back to the room and restart. And there we go, that was BK skip for you. Quite a scary trick, but be careful not to die at Bongo Bongo, or else you will likewise have to restart the trick all over again. But as long as you get out with at least 2 bomb chews, assuming you don't do spirit hover, then you are fine, you should be able to complete the run. Now let's move on to the next thing that I wanted to talk about earlier, the mega side hop that you perform in Gyarados Valley. While it is most definitely possible to perform a super stride instead, which has the added advantage of making Link reach the fortress much quicker if done well, I definitely think that as a beginner, doing that also works well. Performing the trick itself isn't hard, all you really have to do is pull out the bomb, shield drop it by, well, pulling out the shield, and then roll forward. Then you do a back jump to place Link pretty much perfectly. You then wait until the bomb is about to explode, then do a dry roll by just having the shield pulled up and pressing A. And as soon as Link touches the explosion, you basically do a side hop either to the left or to the right, both are fine in this case, all while keeping the shield up. Once you see that Link has a lot of momentum backwards, remove the shield and put on the hover boots, and put your stick backwards, and Link should be able to perfectly reach the other end of the bridge safely. Where there is a risk with this strat is in the positioning of the bomb, because if Link isn't placed well, even with correct timing, he will miss the explosion, meaning that the mega side hop still won't occur. It's a problem I tended to have, which is that when I did my backflip to get into position, I didn't consider the slope that is right here, and because of that, Link's positioning would be screwed up. This therefore seems really simple, but all I would like to add to this for your own consideration would be to simply have Link drop the bomb slightly further up, so that Link just is up right at the edge of the slope by the time he backflips. That way, you are sure to be in the correct positioning, and the mega side hop should therefore work well. That's it, that's all I had to say about this moment. So let's move on to something that is quite important to consider, that part being the wasteland. The reason why I feel it needs a special mention is because of a certain specific section of it being the last one. See, the principle of the wasteland is that if you go out of the path, you void out and come back to the very beginning of the desert. At the beginning we just use the flags as a visual cue for moving around in the correct direction, so this is simple enough. However, in the normal playthrough, you are then supposed to be using the Lens of Truth to view the Po that then guides you through the second half of the wasteland. Problem is, we just don't have it in the run, so this means that we can't use that casual method to get past it. In that scenario, as well explained on Zelda's tutorial, a common visual cue that can be used are the seams that separate the regions you can walk in and where it will vault you out. Now of course, this footage right here is showing you the seams through the collision viewer, which makes it very easy. However, in actual gameplay, it's definitely much harder to see. Therefore, something that I can definitely recommend is firstly to try and manage to get to the wasteland during the daytime, since that will help making the seams at least slightly more visible, which definitely will be of a great help. However, despite that, they still remain fairly difficult to spot, So usually, having a consistent route for this area will definitely help with remembering where they are. For me, what I do is depart from that flag specifically, which therefore allows me to start off with the same positioning every time. And therefore, right from the get-go, I already know my starting point and which seams in the sand I need to be wary of. In this case, what I would want to do is walk forward for a bit, and then follow that seam here. Then, when reaching that X-like area, I go to the right side of it and cross over to the other side. Then, this one is probably the harder to spot, but I follow this seam specifically for a while. However, not for too long, as there is another seam in front of you that will void you out if you go ahead for too long. Once you reach near it, you then go to the left and go down, and you will then see the triangle-shaped dune. Climb over it and then go slightly to the right, and you should see the two flags that signal the entry of the Desert Colossus area. However, do proceed with care in this area. After climbing up the dune, just have to make sure you stay on the left enough to not cross that seam, and you should be fine in order to reach the Desert Colossus. Now that we're past that, you can either perform the Spirit Hover or go through the beginning of the Spirit Temple. It is as you want. Zelda's tutorial goes very well into the details, so there isn't much more that I can say. The only thing I may add, which is related to what I spoke about earlier, is the BK skip, or option not to do that, towards the end. If you go for the option of not going for the BK skip and decide to pick it up, this will therefore require you to do a trick where you unload the mirror on the floor so that you can then do a mega side hop that then lands you next to the boss door, which you can then hookshot to and then open with a key. While those parts are fairly easy, I just want to provide a little warning, which is that in order to actually unload the door, you need to leave the room at the same time as this interrupter is activated. However, there is unfortunately a window of time in which if you happen to open the door in that wrong time, you will end up softlocking the game. Yeah, not fun. That's why usually, as a failsafe, I usually tend to save right before that moment, so that way, if I have that happening, all I need to do is reset the console, restart my file and walk all the way back. This in a no reset mentality, of course. But yeah, that's pretty much all of what I had to say regarding this section. Now, in terms of what I want to talk about next, we are skipping all the way to the end of the run, specifically the tower collapse section of the run. Luckily, unlike in any percent, doing the void warp is a lot simpler and doesn't involve getting your head from the falling boulder to then void into the load zone of the tower. No, our method is a lot simpler for this category. As explained on Zelda's tutorial, the process is simple. You place yourself on this wall and side hop right. Then, target, go forward and crouch tap the wall in front of you. Then side hop right, slash sword at the barrier while aiming and then put shield up the first time. Then a second time. Then backflip, one side hop, and while doing the second one, place a bomb which when it explodes will lead you to arrive inside the tower. Now in that first part, there are a few risks to consider, which unfortunately is mainly due to RNG, meaning you cannot really control that. Mainly, that is, the boulders falling. It is definitely possible for them to fall on you during any point in the setup, which could easily ruin it. If that happens, the best thing to do is to just restart it. Once again, this is unfortunately RNG, so there isn't really much you can do about it. All you gotta do is bless RNG and hope that this won't happen to you. However, the risks of the tower collapse aren't done here. First off, it is important to check that you have enough hearts, meaning at least two, because otherwise, this means that the fall damage when falling will then kill you, which you obviously don't want. But speaking of that fall down, see, it mainly relies on getting a few things right. Firstly, on setting Link's angle correctly, and then having the correct jump slash timing while pressing the stick forward in that moment. If this isn't done correctly, Link may end up not falling in the correct area, thus ruining the entire moment. If you end up stuck, you can always kill yourself using bomb chews, or if that is possible, just try and void out, which if you are almost out of health, should kill you and therefore put you back at the beginning with enough health to retry the trick entirely. And now, but certainly not least, let's talk about Ganon. This is stuff that Zelda does talk about in his tutorial, but I feel it's worth talking about, and that is, what you must do if you fail to superslide into the battle, meaning that you will have no sword for the first half of the battle. In that case, all you will need to do is use the hookshot by shooting Ganon's tail instead of slashing it with the Master Sword. This unfortunately does take quite a lot more time, requiring 10 hits instead of 3, but at least if you do fail it, you know that your run isn't entirely screwed up. And that is it for this section. Phew, that was lengthy. That should be useful to a few people. I hope so at least. Once again, remember, all of the videos that I may refer to are in the description of the video, so it should be easy for you to access all those resources if you need to. Now that this is done, it's time to talk about the last section of the video, the marathon safety of Ocarina of Time GSR. After all, as discussed earlier, the run will be done in a marathon setting, being the 3D Zelda challenge itself. We cannot allow a reset of the run midway through. it has to be completed, and therefore, risky parts of the run can be quite a threat to its completion in a reasonable time. If you have watched the entire video in one sitting up until now, then you may already have some ideas of what sections will be quite a threat for its marathon safety. The first and foremost aspect to consider is the amount of bomb chews you have throughout the run. After all, they are necessary for quite a few moments in the run, and running out of bomb chews could definitely put the run in a tough spot. Luckily though, in terms of actual necessity, the last time you actually need a bomb chew is in Dodongo's Cavern. While you do need bomb chews for the Spirit Hover, it still doesn't change the fact that you can always just pass by the first half of the Spirit Temple itself, meaning that in the worst case scenario, as long as there are enough bomb chews by that point, it should be fine. The reason why they are quite troublesome is that unlike normal bombs, which can be normally picked up through rocks, pots and enemy drops, it is not the case for bomb chews, meaning that in the context of a run, the batch that you get in the bottom of the well is all you have. Luckily though, there is definitely room for error, so running out of bomb chews shouldn't be too much of an issue. There definitely are many moments in the run that while they aren't run killers in the sense that they make it impossible to complete, they do lead to relatively large amounts of time loss. This includes, for instance, cutscene skips in the courtyard or in the meadows, in which case failing the cutscene skips will require you to watch them in their entirety and learn the songs normally, which isn't really a situation you want to find yourself in. Two moments in the run that can add quite a lot of time in the run if not done well include, for instance, the Shadow Temple BK skip or the Wasteland section. After all, as previously discussed, failing them requires you to restart them in their entirety. What is even worse in the case of the BK skip is that since it requires at least 2 bomb chews per attempt, as well as enough health to handle both the fall down to the platform and the hit from the second bomb chew, this means that too many attempts at the trick may lead to not enough bomb chews for the rest of the run, or not enough health for the trick to be completed. Hence why I recommend to save right after getting the hover boots, meaning that though you do have to walk all the way back to the room, you can still be sure that you can have as many attempts as you need. All you need to make sure is that by the time you're done with it, you at least have 2 bomb chews for the Dodongo's Cavern, assuming you do not do Spirit Hover later. When it comes to Wasteland, there unfortunately isn't really any other way around it. If it's failed multiple times, there is no choice but to keep trying until you make it. This is why practicing this moment many times on the practice ROM is definitely something I recommend, so you can get used to your visual cues for the Wasteland. Eventually, you will be able to make it to the other side first try, or second or third try, which marathon-wise should be good enough. Now then, regarding the previously mentioned Spirit Hover, learning the first half of Spirit Temple is basically entirely for marathon safety. In the context of a run, after all, it is not all just a difficult trick on its own, but it requires the use of both bombs and bomb chews, and therefore, due to its limited quantities, running out of them can be a risk. While it is possible to refill in bombs with some rocks and attempt to replace bomb chews with normal bombs, it definitely isn't the most convenient thing to do. Therefore, it can be concluded that Ocarina of Time GSR, while it can be a bit risky at times for marathon safety, it is usually well countered with backup strats that can still allow the run to be completed. The only risk to be really wary about that can actually be deadly for it is to run out of bomb chews prior to be done with the Dodongo's Cavern at the very least. All of this is good. The lower the risk for a run to completely die off and for the run to be impossible to complete, the better it is when it comes to the 3D Zelda challenge. Of course, Ocarina of Time is probably the game that can most afford to be not safe for marathons due to it being the very first game I will complete in the challenge, but obviously that's how we want it to be for all the games, and hopefully that will be the case when I get to explore the other games. And phew! I can say something that I never thought I'd be able to say with this video. We're done! Ocarina of Time GSR is quite an exciting speedrunning category to play. It is challenging, makes you see quite a lot of the game as a whole, and while it is long enough to test your endurance, especially due to its difficulty, it definitely doesn't overstay its welcome, and it feels very satisfying to finish such a run. Hopefully, when the 3D Zelda challenge happens, we will be able to complete it with a decent time. Now, what's next? This is a very good question considering some things are still up in the air. At the moment of making this video, the rules regarding the 3D Zelda Relay have yet to be updated considering all the developments for Zelda speedrunning in 2019.
It probably will be a while until the rules are decided so that I can stay accurately on the rules. However, even despite that, I have one other thing to consider, which is ESA Winter 2020, since most likely I will be running Skyward Sword any percent at that time. So if that does happen, it means I will need to grind that game and focus on it for a while. So it means my 3D Zelda challenge plans will need to be put on hold. However, I suppose that most likely my next game will be Majora's Mask, due to the similarity it has with Ocarina of Time when it comes to the speedrunning mechanics. But it really depends on how things turn out.
So, everyone, thank you for sticking through the entire video. I hope you have a nice day, and either see you on my streams as I learn the next speed games for the 3D Zelda challenge, or see you on its next video. Bye!